Hey everyone, and welcome for another exciting, I'm sure it's going to be exciting episode of Ask Marc. I already see questions firing away in the chat. That is awesome. As always, we are joined by Mr. Marc Randolph. Marc Randolph, as you know, is one of the founders and the founding CEO of Netflix. Netflix has a very special day today, which we'll ask Marc about. But once we get going, we have a lot of questions already fired in, but as you guys are already doing in the chat, please send them in. Marc, as you know, if you've watched this show before, he is just full of knowledge and cannot wait to share it with the rest of you. This man has funded and helped countless startups get off their feet. Let's see, who do we got here? We got Vienna, we got Miami, we've got all the way from, I think someone's from Long Island. That's pretty amazing. So we're just waiting for Marc to connect here. I think we might be having, oh, there he is.
I like watching like watching you stall there, Dan. That was good.
Yeah, yeah. Could you hear the flop sweat starting to form on my face? Well, I'm glad you're here. I thought you got so nervous that you were going to have to talk to me that you bolted, but you got your courage together. So, Marc, as I noted, today is a very special day in the history of Netflix, the company that you helped found. Do you want to tell everyone about it?
Yeah, today, Dan, is the 21st anniversary of our IPO. So today at this time, actually a few hours ago this day, I was actually in New York. I was on the trading floor at Merrill Lynch watching Netflix go public. And it was kind of interesting in a way. There's an expression that says that compares an IPO is kind of like your high school graduation, which is it's a big deal at the time. But looking back, you kind of recognize it's just a milestone. And it was a big deal at the time because having an IPO for a startup is in some ways the payoff for your hard work. It's kind of what you have promised all your investors. It's what all the employees you convinced to quit their other jobs and come work to you. Now all of a sudden their stock is worth something. So it's kind of a big moment. But on the other hand, you know, the next day you got to go back to work. You still have to fight off Blockbuster and Walmart. You still got to get ready for streaming. It's a bit easier having the resources, but it's not necessarily the be all and end all.
Did you have like a dartboard in your house with Blockbuster as the target? And were you just throwing stuff at it every day? How did that go?
No, it was more of that at work was plenty. So I got home, it was a no Blockbuster zone. Just didn't want to think about that anymore. And this was still early enough that, you know, they were still very, very much a threat for quite a while after that, too. It got way worse before it got better.
All right. Well, congratulations for that. I love how you started that. Yeah, it was an interesting day.
Well, you know, actually, it was in some ways, it's a little bit of an anticlimax because, you know, listen, when you think about an IPO, what you picture is the crowd of excited entrepreneurs on the balcony and they're ringing a bell and maybe there's ticker tape and there's all the traders on the floor. Well, that's the New York Stock Exchange. And we went public on NASDAQ, which is basically a whole bunch of computer servers in a server room out in Weehawken, New Jersey, or something like that. So the only, there's no bell, there's no confetti. You're basically standing around watching a whole bunch of Merrill Lynch bankers trying to match up the trades until finally it scrolls across the ticker, and that's the moment you cheer. But
that's great.
One more little story about that. So I was in New York and I had my son with me, and Reed was there, and Barry McCarthy, our CFO. And my job was, I was supposed to provide color commentary for all of the people back in Los Gatos. And everyone had come in at 6:30 in the morning and they had breakfast. They were all waiting because this was the big day and they had me on speakers. But it was also a little anticlimactic because nothing happens. So you're calling in going, well, we're standing around, people are talking on the phone. You know, it's kind of like, you know, I've compared it to the a play-by-play announcer at a baseball game when it's on rain delay.
Right.
I think something interesting to say until something actually happens.
That's
a good thing. And listen, the vast majority of startups don't get that opportunity. So I mean, obviously what a thrill.
Yeah. Well, a lot of people with startups now in the chat room, sending in questions. And, you know, we've started talking a little bit about money there. So, you know, this is an oldie but a goodie. This is from Linda Grigo. And she's wondering, these days, what do you think is the best avenue for raising money for your startup?
So it's an important topic. You know, I kind of say that the CEO really only has these three responsibilities, which is set the vision of the company, make sure the right people in the right seats, and don't run out of money. And so you've got to be thinking about that, but it's so dependent on where you are. And quite frankly, most people raise money way too early. They think, I have to raise money in order to get started. I need to raise money so I can pay. When you start raising money, you've just upped your stress level hugely because now you've got to deliver. Because usually you end up spending that money. You hire people. You begin accruing all kinds of fixed costs. So my first advice is wait as long as you can. Hack it. Do it as a side gig. Do it nights and weekends. Do it in a non-repeatable, non-scalable way. The longer you can wait to raise money, the better. But once you finally do have something that works, you have some evidence that you found product market fit, you have some evidence that your idea actually is a good one, again, start small. I mean, we used to call the seed round the friends and family round because you'd go to your friends and your family and you'd tell them because they'd be willing to bet on you without necessarily having all this empirical proof that it's going to work. Then there's another tier in this seed round category, which are basically investment clubs where they all pool small checks and small amounts of money to make small grants. And they're delighted to have you, especially if you're local, go in and pitch to them. But raising money by going through the professional channels, going to VCs, even seed round VCs, you have better have your act together or have a track record. So I'm answering this in a somewhat oblique way. My answer is to raise money, don't. Start by spending as little as you can because the more traction you have and the more evidence you have your idea is a good one, the easier it will get. If you are at that point and you've said, I have proven that I can build a machine where I put a dollar bill in one end, turn the crank and out comes $2, then you'll have no problem raising money because now you've demonstrated that you have something as opposed to doing the hand waving, imagine if you will.
I got to get me one of those machines. You put a dollar in it, you say, and it cranks out two. That's great.
That is what a repeatable, scalable business model is. And the more you can prove that, and companies can prove that, they can say, hey, for every dollar of acquisition cost I put in, my first order is $1.50. Of that $1.50, my margins are 90%. I mean, you can make the math come out, even at small scale, and say, I have built this machine. It's got rubber bands and paper clips, and I have to sit there manually watching it the whole time. But I've proven that I have something people want that they're willing to spend money on, that they give me more money than it costs me to provide the good or the service. That's what you need to prove, because then you're not saying, believe in me. You're saying, this works. Now you just need to believe that I have the chops to scale it. And that's a much, much easier ask.
That's great. So Netflix, obviously a huge success, as a lot of things that you've been associated with. But we got a question in from Sandesh Gowda asking, how do you pick yourself up from a crushing failure? Like, not like things didn't go right, like things went really bad.
Drugs and alcohol. No, I'm kidding, of course. You know, the first thing is that it's going to happen. You know, listen, this is not an easy job. You are betting all the time on things that are uncertain. So I would be lying to you if you said it doesn't happen. And I don't know that I have a technique that I use. And maybe it's just the way I'm wired, but I'm not sure this is a word, preternaturally, maybe. I'm just driven to be optimistic about things. And the question I get asked all the time is, what's your biggest failure? You know, and it's an impossible question to ask because I don't think about it that way anymore. I am so used to trying things that I have no idea in advance whether they're going to work or not. Every single thing I try, I have no idea if it's going to work. And what a surprise, most of them don't work. But what I've learned after 40 years of doing this is, even when things don't work, I always learn something interesting. This is a really abstract one. It's like nuclear physics, that when they do these super colliders and they try and send an atom at super high speeds and collide it with something, not because it does anything useful, but because they want to see what happens. And that's what you spend every single day doing as an entrepreneur. You're trying shit and you want to see what happens. And most of it doesn't work. But I've now become so used to doing that I get excited about it, because every time it doesn't work, I learn something. So the disappointments, yes, some of them are very profound. I mean, some of them were, wow, this really didn't work. This set us back months. This cost me a lot of money. But I can't help it. It may be a little bit more than a few minutes. It might be a day or two. But finally, I go, wow, that was really interesting. I wonder if I could try this. And then I'm right back at it again. But I guess this can be the last thing I'll say to be a bit more concretely helpful, is the trick is to make sure the scale of your experiments is sufficient for you to handle them not working. What the biggest disaster is someone going, I've got a great idea. And then they plow millions of dollars and months of time and lots of people into seeing if it works. And then it doesn't work and go, wow, what a disaster. That's why I'm so accentuative of saying, start small, make small steps, figure it out along the way.
Awesome. Awesome. And kind of in step with that, Dustin G wrote in saying, I taught myself graphic design, product design, and web design to keep startup costs low. What else do you recommend I learn?
Learn to code. I mean, certainly, listen, it depends upon what your interests are. But learning to code is an unbelievably valuable skill. And not necessarily because you're going to code your product yourself. But it's like learning a foreign language. It just allows you to communicate with the people who speak it fluently, even if you don't speak it fluently. So if you are running a startup, and if you eventually, you can build the prototype yourself, and you can say, this really sucks because I'm a beginner at this, and I'm using all kinds of low code and no code options. But you are able to put together the prototype by yourself, and you've been able to demonstrate that this thing works by yourself. Now, it's not repeatable, it's not scalable, it'll fall apart, there's no ability to really spread it out, but it's enough to demonstrate. And we said in the previous question, it's enough to demonstrate to someone who's going to fund you, but it's even more powerful at demonstrating to someone who is a technical person that they should join you. Because now you've taken away a lot of the risk of this, and now you've gotten them excited. But the big thing about what you should, why you should learn how to code, is it's so valuable when you're talking to them and she or he says, this doesn't work because of this, or I have to use this approach because of this, to actually know what the hell they're talking about, as opposed to having your eyes roll back in your head, like, I have no idea what language you're talking. It's such a huge, huge thing. It's why I encourage everyone in college to take some courses in that, if not because you want to be a coder, but just because it's become the new lingua franca of startups.
And we had a question from Tristan Day, and I wonder if it's any different, but he says, hi, Mark, I teach entrepreneurship at the high school level. What do you think is the most important thing young entrepreneur students should know?
The most important, I mean, I teach entrepreneurship at the high school level too. It's a fantastic time. Because all the skills that I have, I learned before I was in high school. You practice these things. So the most important skill I think they should learn is idea validation, is how to hack, how to say, I have an idea. How can I be clever enough to figure out some way to find out if this works without spending money, without hiring people, without having to code something? How can I break my idea down to its fundamental piece? How do I collide my ideas with real people as quickly and easily as I can? Because that is what an entrepreneur does every day. And the way you learn that is by practicing it. And high school is a great way to do it in a low stakes way. I imagine you probably already do mock companies where you say, hey, let's all invent a product together. Because the very act of doing it and seeing what's involved in trying to see what customers want and how they react to what you're trying and how to do these things with no money and no time, hugely important skills. So don't lecture. Don't do pitch competitions, for God's sake. That's the biggest waste of time. Let people take the actual steps that they would go through if they were actually trying to make their business real.
I just want to say hi to people, Mark, people from around, literally around the world, Trinidad and Tobago, Colombia, France, Mexico. They're coming in from all sides. And
that's awesome.
Yakun asked a question that I've been wondering, and perhaps you know the answer. He says, Mark, do we live in a simulation?
Well, that's the thing about living in a simulation. You never know you're living in a simulation. I mean, until you begin to see the glitches in the matrix.
Yeah.
But I'm not going to tell you anything about that.
Okay. All right. Sorry. We'll have to tune in next time to see if Mark will share more of the answer. Well, okay, let's bring it back down to reality a little bit here. We've talked about finding a co-founder. Victoria Lagu says she's looking specifically for an MD or PhD co-founder for a mental health-related startup. I know that's very specific, but maybe using that specific example, you could give a larger example of how do you find a good co-founder?
Well, let me start off with one of the flaws. And what I thought this was going to go was, I have this great idea and I'm looking for a PhD computer scientist to build it for me. Because my God, how many people say that? A million. And I hate to break it to you, but those PhD computer scientists have no interest in building your idea. They want to build their own idea. So you really do have to recognize what it is that someone's going to want. Let's talk about the PhD in mental health. So for your startup, in my opinion, there is two ways to go about this. And one is you meet the person previously in some other life. You meet them in some other context. And you both begin to realize you share common views about a problem. And you decide, wouldn't it be interesting to solve this problem together? And that's a pretty stable way to do it, because you get relationship first and then business second. And I'm doing checklist in my head really quickly. I think every single time that I've done a startup and there's been co-founders involved, these are people that I knew before, that we recognized we had different skill sets that were complementary. And we're able to then say, well, what problem should we try to solve and look for that problem together? The other way, there's three of them, not two. The second one, and this might be more appropriate to what you're doing, is rather than saying, let's solve my problem, why don't you find these PhDs and the specialists you're looking for and see what problem they'd like to solve, and then have you help them solve their problem, which might resonate a bit better. But the most valuable way to find a co-founder, if you have not done one of those previous two approaches, is the exact same way we talked about for the fundraising piece, which is just start. Start doing what you think would be a great idea. And I recognize you don't have the expertise. You recognize you're not going to be able to make it big or repeatable or scalable. It doesn't make a difference. You just want to demonstrate in some way that you're not crazy. And saying not repeatable and not scalable means you don't need coding. You don't need money. You don't need any of those things. You just need some way to collide it with a customer and see whether someone really wants it. And the reason that if you take those initial steps, it's so powerful for a co-founder is because then you can go to these people who you think would be interesting and not say, hey, will you start a company with me? But say, can I get your advice? And look at what I'm doing. Look at what's happening here. And I've seen this happen over and over again. Let's say you've got this great thing you're doing and it's starting to work, but you're pulling your hair out because you're doing it on a yellow pad and you have 3x5 cards and you're doing everything manual because you don't know a lick about coding. And you bring in someone who is an engineer. And you go, can you just help me think about this differently? And I promise what happens is they begin looking at it and they go, well, you could do this. You could do this. Oh, this is kind of interesting. Oh, you've got a lot of traction here. Maybe. And then you'll see it shifts into maybe we could try this. Or maybe I could come in and just help a little bit on the side. They get excited about the problem because they see firsthand that the problem is real and you actually stumble onto something that solves it. And it's a very, very powerful recruiting tool, but it only works if you take those initial steps and begin to demonstrate that there's a there. And as I've said over and over, and I'll say it again, and I've said it in previous Ask Marks, the real skill is not how good you are at coming up with an idea. The real skill is how clever and creative you can be in figuring out a quick, cheap, and easy way to collide it with reality and find out whether it's real or not. If you're building a minimal viable product, you're building way too much. Just do something that proves that someone really wants what you have to offer.
That's great. That's great. Getting lots of love in the chat, Marc. People are loving this. So we're coming up on time, but I think we could squeeze in maybe two more. Julia Shelton asks, we're in a service-based field, specifically florals and events. Do you have any advice on how to ride momentum and get consistent revenue? So I guess she's saying, you know, there's a big season for them and then it drops off.
Yeah,
it's a big season. Keep going.
It's a trick because seasonality is a problem in a lot of businesses. And there's a couple of approaches. One is you build your business to tolerate seasonality by really being careful about fixed costs. You structure the business in a way that during your peaks, you're using temp labor. During your peaks, you're using things that are more expensive on a per transaction basis, but that you can turn on and turn off so that you can spend a lot of money during the periods where you're active, but then cut your costs way back when you're not active. The second thing is to begin to look for counter-cyclical things to balance your businesses. So what is a third area you could go into perhaps that would carry you in the periods when it's not as popular? And again, they don't need to be the things that drive you. You're just talking about how do I bring in enough revenue to maintain this service base that allows me to scale back up when the real season happens. And the third thing is, to whatever degree you can I convert my pricing into non-single event pricing and more into subscription pricing? And obviously not all, that doesn't suit all things, but it might suit more things than you think. And that, of course, allows you to basically say, if you're willing to commit to work me working with you over the course of a year, I can certainly do something about your pricing. And those are the three things that I would consider without knowing much in detail about what it is specifically you're doing.
Excellent. So a lot of comments, not so much questions, but comments about AI, which we haven't talked about too much here, but I'm wondering, I guess this goes to the simulation question. are we going to be two chatbots talking in a year from now? What do you think? How do you think things are going?
So I'll say right now, I'm excited. I think it's a tremendously exciting time. And there's a bunch of reasons I think that. Number one is, by my nature, I'm a disruptive person. I don't mean I interrupt you, but I mean, I see entrenched businesses and all of a sudden something comes along that allows you to do something totally differently. And that excites me rather than scares me. Back when I worked for a big company once in my life, you know, they'd announce, we're doing a big reorg. And 95% of the people would go, oh my God, oh no, a reorg. And I'd be going, oh my God, this is awesome. We're going to shake everything up. And AI is going to shake everything up. The second thing is, new technologies take a long time before they figure out what their best and highest uses are. And to get there, they're tried in lots and lots and lots of different places. And we've seen that over and over and over again. We just can't imagine right now what is the best and highest use for AI. And I think you've got to be patient and realize we're going to try things that just aren't going to work that well, or they're going to create more problems than they solve. The third thing, though, and this is maybe to your question, to your answer, Dan, about are we going to be two chatbots here talking in the future? I kind of hope so. You know, my dad, he was an engineer, and he was amazing with a slide rule. And of course, all the other engineers that worked with him were amazing with a slide rule. Because if you wanted to do fast, higher mathematics, you had to be great at a slide rule. And when the calculator came around, yes, no one needed to use the slide rule anymore. So all the people who were great at their jobs because they were great at slide rules didn't have jobs anymore. But what it did is it freed these people up who were smart to work in an entirely higher plane, because most of their time was not spent anymore doing calculations. When I started off in direct marketing, we didn't have spreadsheets, if you can believe how old I am. And yet to do all these calculations of return on investment and lists for direct marketing, I did it all longhand. And of course, when the spreadsheet, I didn't bemoan the fact that, oh, all my skill at doing it longhand is worthless. I went, oh my God, I can do that stuff now in 1 minute and have the rest of the day to think of clever things to do. And I think AI is the same way. There's so many things right now we spend time on that I think AI is going to free us up to be thinking at a much, much higher level. And that's what excites me. Are there scary things? Yes. Is the world going to end? God, I hope not. I'm just more excited to see where it goes. And I should have taken it back. So, you know, what should I learn? Yeah, learn coding, but for God's sake, learn AI too. It's going to impact every single business. And so you had better, you don't need to do it. And you certainly shouldn't do it just for the sake of doing it. But you better think about, does it have a role? Because if it does have a role and you're not incorporating it in your business, you're leaving yourself susceptible to someone else incorporating it and pushing you out of the way.
Yeah, and well, that sort of dovetails into a question that's come up a couple of times in the chat, and we actually got it submitted, but people are concerned about protecting their ideas. When you put your ideas out there, people are going to steal it. Should I be trademarking it? What are your thoughts on that?
I think it's tragically wrong. It's just tragically wrong. It's worse than a waste of time. I mean, the first thing is no one's going to steal your idea. And if they do, who cares? That isn't the point. Ideas rarely survive a collision with real customers intact. They morph and they change. So if you think your idea is what's going to make you win, you are deluding yourself. Execution is what makes you win. Realizing when you finally do collide your idea with a real person and they see he doesn't want that, he wants this variation of it. How well are you able to recognize why you are wrong and how to change it and pivot and pivot and pivot again? No company is successful doing the thing that the original idea said was important. The skill is that pivoting and shifting and reacting. So who cares? You can give 50 people your idea, and if you're better at executing it, you're still going to win. The idea doesn't make a difference. But here's why I said it's tragic and awful, is that the idea is 1% of what's going to make you successful. This colliding the idea with other people is 99% of what's going to make you successful. That's where you're going to learn what's right and what's wrong, what to fix, what to change. And not just colliding it with customers, colliding it with other employees, other companies, friends, anybody who could give you some insight into whether it's a good idea or not by bouncing your idea off them. So here's the tragedy. By protecting your secret, you're protecting the thing which is 1% of your success formula, and not doing the thing which is 99% of your success formula. That's just tragic. Don't listen. If you've invented a new drug or some new amazing chemical compound, sure, get IP protection. Listen, not everything is one size fits all, but 99.9% of the ideas that everyone in the chat has, tell everyone you know, and you'll move a lot faster than you will keeping your precious little secret in your head.
That's great. All right, we've got time for a couple more. Maybe this will be quick. This was from Danielle Sims wanting to know, how do I obtain my first client?
Well, it'll be the person before your second client. I have no idea how to attain your first client. Go out and pitch somebody. Go out and sell something. Go out and make something or do something or try something. But listen, there's a bunch of, God, I'm like a broken record today about there's no reason you can't go out right now and sell someone as your first client. In fact, the best first clients are the people who have some desperate need for something that they're willing to accept it in a completely broken state. So if you've got something you think is compelling, go sell it to someone right now, even though it's not ready, even though it's not fully featured. Even better, what I've seen a lot of companies do is they sell it to someone before they've built it. And they tell the person the truth, but the person goes, oh my God, that is so amazing. I am so desperate for that. I'd be happy. I'm committed. You've sold me. Now deliver it. And then you go, okay, now I know. And then you have someone not only who you know will buy it from you, most likely, but more importantly, you've got someone who will give you feedback along the way. You can begin delivering incremental products and have them tell you, this is on track, it's off track. The way to get your first client is to start. And whatever you're waiting for, stop waiting. I mean, go out and sell it. Go out and find your first client today. That's how you find the first client. You start.
That's great. Well, we'll give you one more question, but before we get to that, a lot of people wanting to know how they can connect with you, how they could hear more. Obviously, you've got the That Will Never Work podcast and your book, markrandolph.com. Any other ways people can connect and get more Mark in their lives?
Well, the best way is ground zero for me is my website, which is markrandolph.com, all one word with a C in Mark. But the reason I point that out is that that is everything. You can find all my socials, and I do post regularly on Twitter, on Instagram, on LinkedIn, and even on TikTok. But also you can sign up. I do a weekly newsletter where I kind of share all my thoughts. There's a whole bunch of ways I'm trying to spread the love. And that's the place to find the one that matches with your learning style.
Excellent. Excellent. All right. One last question from Fayez, who asks, Mark, do you believe in luck?
Huh? Absolutely. In fact, if you don't think luck has something to do with it, you're deluding yourself. Luck, I mean, the reason I am sitting here talking to you and you actually give a shit about what I have to say is hugely luck. You know, I was in the right place at the right time. Things broke my way. There's a million people who are as smart as I am or smarter, who are hardworking as or harder working than me, who didn't go in the right direction. I mean, and just, you know, for example, way back when we did Netflix, we bet on DVD. We bet on DVD when it was just barely at a test market. And if DVD had gone the way of the Laserdisc, and you don't know what a Laserdisc is? Well, that's my point exactly. Netflix wouldn't have made it. And I wouldn't be here. If Blockbuster had said yes to the $50 million offer, I wouldn't be here. I mean, so much of that is luck. Now, don't get me wrong. There's the old standby that luck is really preparation meets opportunity. So yeah, I hustle. I try and protect myself as best I can about things going wrong. And I try to anticipate as best I can how I take advantage of things going right. But man, luck is a big part of being an entrepreneur. And, you know, embrace it. And sometimes you get lucky. In fact, Barry McCarthy, our CFO at Netflix, I'm going to close with this one. He used to say to me about Reed, he goes, man, that Reed Hastings is the luckiest guy I know. And he goes, I would so much rather be lucky than skilled. So there you go.
Excellent. Excellent. Well, we are very lucky to have you impart this wisdom on such a regular basis. Mark, it's always awesome hearing what you have to say. And for everyone who sent in questions, thank you so much for watching. MarkRandolph.com, Mark with a C. That's where you're going to want to see all of Mark's great stuff. And this video will be available on entrepreneur.com. So, Mark, I wish you luck in the mountain race you were talking about earlier today. Yeah. Mark does all kinds of things, people.
Crazy. He's crazy. But I can't help it. Well, thank you, Dan. This was great. And thanks to everybody who sent in questions. We're doing this again, another date in front of me about a month from now. And hope you all come back and maybe I'll get to your question then.
And maybe we'll finally learn if we are living in a simulation. Mark, you got to tell us. We need to know.
I'll do it. What can I do?
All right. Yeah. Take care, everyone.
Thanks, everybody. Soon.